And now, it's time for another Dice Tower Review with Tom Vasel.
Hey folks, I'm Tom Vasel, and today we're taking a look at Root, a game of Woodland Might and Right. Root is made from later games, and it's the next game in their series of apparently four-letter word games after Vast. Now, if you've ever heard of Vast, Vast was a game that kind of blew my mind when I first saw it because it had five different factions in this game that all played very differently. And in fact, you could even, it was about a knight going after a dragon, fighting some orcs with a thief, and then someone was even the cave. Well, Root is the same thing, except this is a four-player game. And in this game, you're going to be one of four different factions, except these factions are going to play completely differently. Let's take a look. Now, first off, realize this. There's a lot going on in Root. There are four different factions, and they each have different rules. The game is actually not that complex when it comes down to it. But please, please do not use this rules overview as a tutorial on how to play the game. I just want to give you an idea, a little bit of how the game works. Now, there are four factions. We have the Marquis de Cat. This faction is the one that's already controlling the board. You'll see them everywhere. There's 12 different clearings here in the board. They start in 11 of them. So they're controlling the board. Their main goal that they're going to be doing over the course of the game is going to be building buildings off their board. And as they do that, they're going to be getting points for building these buildings. Then we have the Woodland Alliance. These guys hate them. You don't notice them at all on the board. But slowly, as time goes by, they're going to be trying to play sympathy in different spots. And maybe even raising up some armies and fighting in different areas. Getting officers over here. And just trying to get all their sympathy on the board. And as the game goes by, they're going to be filling up with different woodland creatures who are going to be joining their side. Then you have the Eerie Dynasties up here, or the Eerie Dynasties, I'm not sure how to pronounce that. These guys are the enemies here of the cats. They have just one roost, but if you'll notice, they have a lot of stuff there, and they're going to be able to burst out. They have a strong leader, however, there's always a chance their leader would be deposed, and for a while they might fall into havoc. Then there's the Vagabond. This guy here is in the middle of the board, and he can actually go into the woods and hide in the woods, and he has items, and he'll have a different relationship with all the different characters. In fact, he can ally himself with one of them and win with them, or he can fight against them. Now, on a player's turn, they're just going to go through their board. Each board's different, so there's Birdsong, Daylight, and Evening. So, for example, here in the Marquis de Cat, it says place one wood. So they might look at their board at each sawmill and say, all right, I have a sawmill here. I'm going to place one wood at that sawmill. That was pretty easy. Then it says down here, I can craft using workshops, take up to three actions, plus one for each bird card that I spend. I can battle, fight somebody, march, recruit, put a warrior at each recruiter, build a building by spending the cost in wood that I have here. And again, as you build these buildings, you get points. Overwork, spend a card to place a wood at an extra sawmill. And then in the evening, I draw one card, plus one card for each one showing. The more buildings I build, the more cards I'll be able to draw at night. The Vagabond's going to play very differently. They're going to refresh some of their items. They're going to be using items to do different actions each round, and then they get to refresh three of them each turn, so that he has four of them. And as the game goes by, maybe in trade with other players or other ways, they're going to get more of these items, which is going to give them more actions. They have a special ability based on which Vagabond you start with. In this case, there's the Thief, but you can also be the Ranger or the Tinker. They each get different starting Vagabonds and have a different special ability. The Vagabond's going to be able to do a whole variety of things, but it depends on what you have available to you and how many you'll spend, remembering you only get three back. And also, as the game goes by, some items will give you more things, like you draw one card every end of a turn, but if you get coins, you'll be able to draw extra ones. And sometimes your items will get damaged, but you'll have a chance to bring them back out of here so you can use them again. The Vagabond also has relationships with the other ones, like I said, and he gets points for having these relationships. And we'll get points all the way at the very end and possibly win along with another player. The Eerie Dynasties, they start with one of the leader here. You'll notice I have the charismatic leader in here, but we also have a despot, a commander, and a builder. You're going to pick one of these, and you're going to have these loyal viziers up in different spots. So one's in recruit and battle. And each round, you're going to have to run through these. So you must recruit in a, it's a bird, so in any location on the board, and you must battle in a spot. And each turn, you're going to be adding another one of these cards. So maybe I'll add this bunny card here to move. That means I need to move to a bunny location on the board. So each location, like for example, here it is a mouse location. And then up in the corner here, you can see this is a bunny location. So you need to do these things. So as the game goes by, you're going to be adding more and more cards and being able to do more and more actions, recruit more, build more. But if you ever can't do an action for whatever reason, then you're going to discard the cards, lose a few points, and you get a new leader. So they have these big bursts of actions, and then they're going to lose some points. But as they build more and more roosts, they're going to get more and more points on the board. And then finally, the Woodland Alliance, who uses these cards to have supporters that they're going to be using to do different abilities. They're going to be able to revolt and drop these sympathy tokens off. If they get all the sympathy tokens on the board, they're going to win. They're going to be able to establish bases. They'll slowly get officers that they'll have here, and the more officers they have, the more military operations they'll be able to do at night. Of course, that also depletes the number of troops they have. You'll see they have a lot less troops than the other two factions. So they're just trying to secretly get a rebellion out there. There's some basic rules in the game that when you move, you can move along a path. So if I'm here, I can move as a cat from here to here because I control the region I'm coming from. You need to have tokens and or soldiers that are there. Whenever you do a battle, let's say the cats and the birds decide to fight here, the attacker, they'll roll. The attacker gets the highest die. That's how many things they kill, up to the number of troops they have. So they would kill three of these, and the birds would kill one of the cats. Although the cats have a special ability where they can rescue theirs and send them back to the hospital if they discard a card. But again, everyone has a bunch of different things, so you're going to all have to figure out where to put everything as the game goes by. Although, again, there's switches in battles, because the Wooden Alliance, when they roll these dice, they use the higher number when they're defending, which is different than all the other creatures. But you can destroy tokens, too. You need to get rid of the sympathy tokens. And if you destroy tokens or buildings of the other player's factions, you'll get points that way. You'll notice that there is a point tracker here at the bottom of the board, and you're going to get points each side has different ways to get points. You can get points from crafting things. Each player has different ways to craft, or you're going to need to have a certain number of whatever the tokens you are need to craft in different bases on the board. And you can build these, which will give you maybe an extra ability. Like if I have this at the start of the evening, I get a free move. Or sometimes they give you an ability, you just get an item. Here I get the bag plus one, then I discard. So I have a bag, which gave me a point. And now I have something to trade with the vagabond. Unless I am the vagabond, which, woohoo, then I can do it. So there's all sorts of cards. There's a few special cards like ambush, where you, when someone attacks you, you can quick take out a couple of their troops. And so all these cards can be used at the top for their suit, which will match one of the different regions on the board. Sometimes you need to do that for actions, and birds are wild. Or they can be used at the bottom for a special ability, or you can build them. There's also a few cards in the deck that are called dominance cards. And if you play these or you discard it, someone else can play it. And it gives you a new way to win the game. So I might say, hey, I'm going to do this. From now on, if I roll three fox clearings at the start of my turn, my bird song, that's the beginning of your turn, then I win the game. Of course, everyone knows you're going for that. Your point token will come off the board, and now that's what you're going for. So that's one way you can win, by using a dominance card, or by getting the 30 points, or if you're the vagabond, by joining someone else who gets the 30 points. That's a quick overview of the game. I gotta say, I really like the wooden pieces here with the little eyes on them. They're cute, they're silly, it's fun, and they're very easily distinguishable from each other on the board. That's great, I like these a lot. The cards themselves are very good quality. They're, again, easy to tell by color and symbology, and again, they're decent quality. The boards themselves. So on the back of the board, it tells you the complexity, so the cats are the easiest ones to play. Their card wealth, how aggressive they are, their crafting ability, here's what they have, here's how you set up, here's some strategies that you can have when you're playing the game. And each one has that. In fact, on the other side of the board, there's another board you can play on. And when you play on this board, each of these regions you'll pick or randomize what kind of animals live there. Also, it's just a really cool looking board to have this winner board. The game also comes with a really nice setup type thing. So essentially each player will get a card that shows you exactly how to set up your first turn. If you want to play a walkthrough game, it tells you what to do, how to set up on the other side. And then there's a learn to play walkthrough, which will tell to go through each turn so you can basically see how that works. Speaking of which, then there is a book on learning to play, which explains all the different basic rules of the game. And then if you want to get nitty gritty, the Law of Root, you can go in here, which has just all the different things. So if you want to see an exact detail of the rules, you can go through this. Overall, not a ton of components really, but a lot of great ones, and it's a really well put together package. Well, I like this game. I really like this game. I like it better than I liked Vast. I thought Vast was fun, but Root is funner. Now here's a couple things. First of all, you'll notice my overview is careful to say there's not a rules explanation. That's because there's a lot going on in this game. When I first went through learning how to play and going through the rules, I'm not gonna fault the rules at all, but there was some going on. Here's the deal though. That was me teaching the game. If you're not teaching the game, you really only need to learn how to play your very own. And the game comes with a card for each faction that says, this is what that faction is trying to do. You get a card for each faction, and it says, this is what that faction is trying to do. This is how you should stop them. And I think as you play through the game, you'll learn real quickly, like, oh, that's what that person's doing. I mean, I'm eager to play. After my first game, I played the Cats. And for my second game, I played a different faction, but I was like, I wouldn't mind playing the Cats again, right? Because I want to see how well they could do, and they play very differently. There's definitely a Sheriff of Nottingham, Robin Hood theme going on here. But as the Cats, I was kind of like, what's everyone mad about? We're peacefully running the land. I just want to build some buildings. We're going to tax people maybe once in a while. Well, that's what we're trying to do. When you play the Woodland Alliance, you're like, oh, these guys are cruel, I gotta fight back, and the birds are just get out of my land. And the Vagabond's just this ninja sneaking through the woods and stuff. Oh, and they all play very differently, and yet they all seemingly have a viable chance to win. Now, I suspect that in many people's first game, the Woodland Alliance will win, if only because the other players won't understand how to stop them as easily. And it's really easy for the cats and the birds to get into a fight with each other, the Vagabond poking them around a little bit. Suddenly, the Woodland Alliance is like, hey, this won the game. So you got to be careful about that. But I think as time goes by, I wouldn't know which one has the advantage. I've only actually played this game with four players because it works so well at four. I've gone through the rules of the two or three player games, and they say if you're going to play these two together, that's how they work if you're playing with these three. And in fact, in a two-player game, because it's short, 30 to 45 minutes, they say just play it twice. You know, then just switch the sides and then add your point totals together, which seems like a reasonable way to do it. But I tell you, I was expecting this game to be longer. It's about 90 minutes to 2 hours. Granted, the first game will be a little bit longer getting these rules down, but once you get going, it's smooth. It's really interesting. The boards, they walk you through your turn. Do this, 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 and this. This is one place where I think this game does a lot better than Vast. Vast, I'm still a little confused on what some of the things do. Here, I could play all four of these factions and know how they work. And I guess there's a faction or two in the expansion or whatever, but taking that out of the equation completely, this is just fun. It's innovative, like really innovative. You say, well, yeah, it's kind of like Vast. It doesn't matter. This takes an area control style game and adds unique and interesting things to it. So really cool that way. Secondly, it's a cute yet cool theme. It feels like Redwall the book series as a game, and I love that. And then behind all that, there's just a solid game in there. One where I'm eager to play all four of the factions. So just thumbs up from me in so many different ways. Great component quality, cool theme, a fun game to play, asymmetrical, but I feel everyone has a chance to win, alternate ways to win, possible alliance. Definitely the Vagabond's the hardest to play. Woodland Alliance is a little harder than that. I mean, a little less hard. The birds are a little less hard, and the cats are the easiest to play, that's for sure. But overall, just entertaining and one I highly recommend. Dice Tower Judgment, amazing.